Okay, well, we're continuing our series on the different names of God. And for me, you know, each name kind of gives us a picture of God and tells us how people relate with God, right? And it's kind of like the different roles that we each play, right? When you see me with Matthew, you know, you see, I'm like this nice, kind father. But if you ever saw me on a volleyball court, it would be a totally different picture because I'm yelling and, you know, I mean, that's what coaches do, right? They yell and they scream and they barking out orders and it's just totally different. Well, I've got different roles. And each role that you find a person in, you get to know their character, their personality. We're the same. I'm the same person, right? You're the same person. But each role you have is a little bit different. Okay, and the names of God are kind of like that. You know, if you only had one picture of God, you would have a warped view of God, right? You know how many people think about the God of the Bible and they think, well, he's judgmental, vindictive, all angry all the time. That's one picture of God, right? Does he judge? Does he punish sin? Does he do those things? Yes, he does. Yes, he does. But that's not the entire picture, right? And actually, if you look at the Old Testament as a whole, you'll see that God is immensely merciful. He'll wait 70, 80, 100, 700 years before bringing about judgment. Now, that is patience. But there comes a limit, right? You parents, you know when you hit the limit, right? I'm a guy, so I don't communicate my limits to Matthew, so it's like, stop, 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 right? And then my voice changes and everything, right? It's like, once you hit that limit, that's the limit, right? I'm not saying God is like that, like, you know, crazy like I am, but God is patient, but there comes a point when he needs to judge, right? And all these different names of God that we've been reading about, we've been studying, just give us different facets, right? So just to give you a quick recap, because I know some of you may not have been joining us the whole time. Pastor John started this series talking about the I Am, the great I Am, right? And the Israelites were in a time, they were in slavery in Egypt. They were wondering, is there a God who cares? Is there a God out there, right? And the Lord came to Abraham, came to Moses and said, I am. I care. I'm here. I'm with you. And I am your God, right? A couple weeks ago, I talked about Jehovah Shema, the God who is present. And what we wrestled with was, we all kind of know that God is here, God is with us. But we looked at the story of Mary and Martha. And we saw how Martha, in her head, she knew that God was here. God was with her. But that didn't translate into God doing something in her life. For Mary, God was not only with her, but when she spoke to Jesus, Jesus wept and Jesus moved and he raised Lazarus from the dead, right? And we talked about the difference between having a head knowledge about God is present and actually knowing that God is present enough to manifest his presence and come into the situation and change things, right? So that was Jehovah Shema. Last week, Pastor John talked about El Shaddai, right? We didn't sing the song. We could have, but we didn't. God Almighty. And he talked about how Abraham experienced God at the ripe young age of 99. Can you imagine having a child at 99? I mean, I think I'm old now that I have Matthew. I think I'm old, but 99, having a child, right? Well, El Shaddai, the God of the impossible, right? We talked about that last week. And in fact, Pastor John had us all write down on a paper something, a prayer request, something that we thought was impossible, right? Did you guys all write that down? I hope you did. I guess this, sorry about that. This mic is kind of, this usually works for everyone except Pastor John. I don't know why, but But it does, right? And so now it's starting to act up more, so we might have to change it. But anyway, we all wrote down something that the God of impossible could do, right? And I hope you keep praying about that. I hope you keep praying about that, because God really does the impossible, okay? What I realized going through all these different names for God is each time God's people had an experience, God gave them a new name. And you know what that told me? Is that each name for God is an invitation for us to experience God in that way, right? You've heard, if you've been in church for a while, you've heard the name Jehovah Rapha. God is a healer, right? And we know that up here, but when we say Jehovah Rapha, that's an invitation for us to receive that for ourselves. And maybe you need healing. And it's an invitation for you to pray and say, God, heal me. I want to experience you as Jehovah Rapha. Okay? So each name comes with an experience. Today, we were going to talk about Adonai Tsevaot. Adonai Tsevaot. Okay? You might see it poorly written, or transcribed as Sabaot, right? But, you know, if you're a really geek like I am and you like to look up Hebrew and read Hebrew, the word is Tsevaot. Okay, so you want to try that with me? You want to try to learn some Hebrew? Okay, so we know the first part, right? Adonai, that's easy. Tsevaot. Okay, and you have to say it with like an Israeli accent too. Right? Okay, Adonai Tsevaot. It means the Lord of hosts, right? But if you look in your Bibles, you may read the Lord Almighty. The Lord Almighty. Some Bibles say the Lord Almighty. Some Bibles say the Lord of hosts. You know what? It's all the same. And it's in the Bible about 240 times. This is a popular name for God, right? And we're gonna talk about what that means, right? So, Lord of Hosts, what do you think? What do you think about when we say Lord of Hosts? Hawaiian host candies? It's macadamia nuts? It's not that. Okay, he's the Lord of Angels, right? Chris Tomlin sings that popular song, "The God of Angel Armies." You know that one? That's the name. That's this name of God. So every time you hear that song on the radio, you go Adonai Tsevaot, right? And you'll know that's the name for God, the Lord of hosts, the Lord of the angel armies, right? And when you say that name to an Israelite, somebody who speaks Hebrew, they would immediately picture a mighty king going into battle with his army behind him, right? That's the picture. That's the picture of Adonai Tsevaot. So what in the world does that mean for us, right? We never charge into battle, right? Well, what we're going to find out and talk about a little bit is we're in a spiritual battle. We're in a spiritual battle. So when we pray and we say, Adonai Tsevaot, come down, come help me, we're inviting an army of angels to come and assist us. All right, we're going to talk about that today. The prime example in the Old Testament about Adonai Tsevaot, there's 240 for me to pick from, right? So I couldn't get a whole lot of them, but a great example, King David. When King David is getting ready to fight Goliath, what name of God is he going to choose? The suffering servant? The lamb? No, none of that. It's Adonai Tsevaot, the Lord of hosts, the commander of the army is with me, and I'm going to take on this insolent giant, and he's going to fall, right? If you turn your Bibles to 1 Samuel 17, verse 45. You can read it on the screen, too. David said to the Philistine, "You come against me with a sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied." Right? That's Adonai Tsevaot. Next one. "This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I'll strike you down, and I'll cut off your head." Ooh, this is getting good, isn't it? Yeah. This very day I will give you the carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel, and his name is Adonai Tzevaot. Okay, so I'm going to stop right there, but here's David, right? He's going up against this giant. Everybody is scared. Everybody is just like, oh, I don't want to fight him. I don't want to fight him. Even the king is like, hey, guys, anyone want to fight this guy? And, of course, the king doesn't want to do it either, right? And only David is there. Why is he there? Why is he willing to take that stand for God? It's because he experienced Adonai Tzevaot. He experienced the Lord as a commander of an army. How did he do that, right? He was out. He was a shepherd tending sheep. And he would be out there and a bear would come up. Right? A bear would come up. And, oh my gosh, I'm not a shepherd. I don't know what I would do if a bear came up, came against me. Well, David was able to kill the bear. A lion would come out, and David was able to kill the lion. And it's not just because he was David, and he was this young teenager, you know, strong teenager. It's because he had the Lord with him. So he had all these experiences throughout his life where he knew God is with me, and he's not just a timid God. He's not just a weak God. He's the Almighty God. He's the God with, backed by 100 million angels, right? And so he, because he experienced that, he knows that, wow, I'm going to take a stand and I'm going to step up. So he does. You know the end of the story. This is not a whole David and Goliath message. We're talking about the name of God, Adonai Tzevaot. But you realize that David, because he understood God, he knew God was with him, not in a timid manner, he was able to take a stand. And part of this message is this, to get you guys to think. Is there an area of your life, is there a situation at work where you need to take a stand? You're not sure what the outcome is going to be, you're not sure what's going to happen, but you just need to take a stand. You're being backed by 100,000 angels. And if we don't understand that, then we become timid and kind of back away from things, right? But what does the Bible say in other places, right? I have not given you a spirit of timidity, but one of power and love and self-discipline, right? A strong mind. That's what God's given us. It comes when we get to know this God who's with us. How's my mic? Pretty bad. Melissa, can you play the song? I wasn't sure if I was going to do this, but I think we have time to listen to this Chris Tomlin song, the God of Angel Armies. Just a couple minutes long, but we'll put up a video, and we can sing along and worship with the video. But this is great. Every time you see this song, you got to think about Adonai Tzevaot. Thanks. Can you switch to the handheld number two if you haven't?
Okay. All right. That's maybe a little softer, but I don't know why this mic pops so much, so we're just going to ignore it. But do you like that song? You've heard it. You've heard it on the radio and stuff before, right? And you've never really known what the God of Angel Armies was, right? But just want to talk about this, because this is the God who's with us. This is the Lord Almighty that Pastor John talked about, who's always with us, right? But he doesn't come alone, right? He brings his friends with him, right? And I think we just kind of gloss over this, because as a church, we don't know too much about angels, right? How many messages, if you've gone to church all your life, how many sermons have you heard about angels? I mean, every year you hear about the angel coming and talking to Joseph and Mary, and you hear little snippets, but have you ever heard a sermon or message about angels? Never, right? And I think the Christian church as a whole, we're missing this great support and this great helper, if you will, right? Ultimately, our helper is the Holy Spirit, but angels are sent to help us, right? And we know very little about them, right? And so today, I'm going to shift gears a little bit, because we're talking about the Lord of hosts, but if we don't understand the hosts part of that, we're still not understanding who God really is in this context, right? Well, what do angels, what do they do primarily? When you read the Bible and you see different things, what do? They're cute little cherubs that just kind of sit. No, they're nothing like that, right? When you're reading the Bible, most of the times, what are they doing? Yeah, sending messages, announcing something, giving clear directions. Joseph, do this. Don't send Mary away. You marry her. You know, they're giving clear instructions, right? Now you begin to think, okay, if angels have been doing this from the beginning of the Bible days, all throughout the Bible, is it still going on? Are they still delivering messages? Are we listening? We don't understand the angels, so perhaps we're missing out. We're praying for things and we're waiting for an answer, and perhaps God has sent an angel with an answer, and we've just kind of missed it because we don't know anything about angels, right? Well, primarily, they are messengers, right? You see it time and time again. They speak to us in dreams. They speak to us as people. They appear as people, and they talk to us, right? They're always just kind of giving out the Lord says. The Lord says. This is what the Lord says, right? And we need that. We need that in our daily life. The other thing they do is they protect us. Right? How many of you guys believe in guardian angels? Okay. Wow, that's only like half of the room. I believe in a guardian angel, right? There's two scriptures that kind of support a guardian angel. In the Psalms, right, it talks about how God, the angels will carry you lest you strike your foot against a stone. That was a scripture that actually Satan used to tempt Jesus when he was in the wilderness for 40 days, right? But the other scripture is in Matthew 18, and it talks about the children, and it says, their angels always see the face of the Father, the children's angels, right? So it never says those angels were only for the kids, but I really believe that we have guardian angels. And if not a personal angel that kind of flies around with you, you know, God will send them to help you when you need it, right? I remember, I wasn't going to tell the story, but I remember driving down the freeway and going over Red Hill, coming back down, coming back home. I remember driving, and I don't know, maybe I was falling asleep or something, but I narrowly missed hitting a car. Like, maybe I was tired or something, right? You have these You fall asleep at the wheel all the time, right? Or is it just me? Well, I was driving, and yeah, I just narrowly missed being hit or hitting this car. And what I noticed was there was another car in the road that was kind of moving around traffic too. It was like a black, it's an all black car. I didn't even see it, you know, when I was driving, but it passed by me, and then I remember thinking, where did that car go? Like I went from Red Hill to going towards Pearl City, and I remember thinking, where did that black car go? Because I never saw it again. I never saw it again. Like, there's no place to exit. We're, you know, once you go that way, there's no place to exit. And I just remember, oh, I wonder if that was an angel protecting me, right? It happens all the time. You probably have your own stories about how something happened and you were protected and you don't know how you survived, right? That was an angel, right? Angels are used by God to provide for us. He brought Elijah food and water when he was in the desert. And they do fight. They do fight. They have swords, some of them, right? Okay, well, in your notes, I gave you a bunch of scriptures with passages about angels and what they've done in the past. And I highly recommend this book called Angels by Dr. Billy Graham. It's a great book. It just tells you everything you want to know about angels. Very, very biblical. And, you know, it's Dr. Billy Graham, right? It's Billy Graham. So he cannot help himself. About five times throughout the book, he invites you to get to know Christ and to begin a relationship with Christ. Because it's Billy Graham. He can't help himself, right? But that, it's a great book. It's so biblical about what it teaches about angels. But here's the best part. You might know a friend who's into angels, who's into the supernatural. This is a book you can give them and say, hey, you know, I found it fascinating to learn what the Bible really says about angels. Why don't you check this out? And Billy Graham will be sharing the gospel with them. It'll just open doors for you to talk with them, right? So anyway, it's a great book, and I just recommend picking up, if not one, pick up like three copies and just have it around, give it to people, because people will come to know the Lord through it. Okay. Well, I want to make it really clear that we're learning about angels and all the things they do. We do not worship angels, right? Let's just agree on that. I have to say it because some of you will just assume, you know, I'm going to go too far. But we do not worship angels, but they play a crucial role. We were just discussing this morning in the first service that in Hebrews 1:14, God says that he sends angels to minister to us, to minister with us and for us, right? And so angels have just an amazing role to play in our lives. But did you know that angels help answer prayers? Do you guys know that? A lot of people don't know this. So I want to read you one more story in the Bible. This is Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 9, verse 3. And it says this. Then I turned my face to the Lord God, seeking him by prayer and pleas for mercy with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. I prayed to the Lord my God and made confession, saying, O Lord, the great and awesome God who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments. Okay, so here's Daniel. We're going to jump down a few verses to verse 20. But here's Daniel. He's in exile, right? He's in exile. He's in the country of Babylon. And he knows that we're not supposed to be here. We're supposed to have our own land, right? And so he goes, what happened? We sinned. We sinned and God is punishing us, right? And so he starts praying about it. He starts confessing his own sin. He starts confessing the nation of Israel's sin. He just confessing. And then, it's an interesting thing, God sends the angel Gabriel to go talk to him. So here's what he says. While I was still speaking and praying, confessing my sin and the sin of the people of Israel, presenting my plea before the Lord my God for the holy hill of God, for the city of Jerusalem, while I was speaking in prayer, the man Gabriel, whom I had seen in the vision at the first, came to me in swift flight at the time of the evening sacrifice. He made me understand, speaking with me and saying, O Daniel, I have now come out to give you insight and understanding. Okay, so this next part is insight and understanding into visions and all the things that Daniel's praying about. Wouldn't that be great to have an angel just come and say, you've been praying about all these things. Let me give you some understanding about all this stuff, right? Jump down to the next. This is actually in verse 10. So we're skipping a vision that Gabriel tells Daniel. But can you jump down to verse 10? Chapter 10? Yeah. Okay. Then Angel Gabriel said to me, Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your heart to understand and humbled yourself before your God, your words have been heard, right? And I highlighted that for you. Because if you're like me, you prayed, and you wonder, does God even hear me? Does God hear these words that I'm saying, or am I just doing this, right? And this is proof. This is the confirmation that Gabriel says, let me give you insight into how prayer works. From the first time you prayed, your words were heard. Isn't that awesome? So we may not get the answer right away, and the answer might be no, but just to know that God hears you every time that you pray, right? So, and he says, okay, so Gabriel, I have come because of your words, right? Next verse. The prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days, but Michael, one of the chief priests, came to help me. Okay, so if you've been in church a while, you know these names, right? Michael is the archangel Michael. Gabriel is this messenger angel that sits in the presence of God and then goes to tell messages, right? Gabriel's the messenger to Mary when she's about to give birth to the Lord Jesus. And so here's what's happening. Gabriel's telling him, this is the spiritual battle that after you prayed, God heard you, and I was sent. But somewhere between me getting to you and giving you the answer to your prayer, the prince of the kingdom of Persia, a demon, met me, hindered me for 21 days until the archangel Michael came to help me, right? This is an insight into the spiritual realm of how prayers get answered and what happens in the spiritual realm, right? And so, isn't it interesting to know, well, one, that God hears us, two, that God, sometimes he sends an answer immediately, but it took the slow boat to China and didn't get to Hawaii until 21 days later, right? Not really the slow boat, but you get what it's saying, right? There is a spiritual battle that we are all involved in, and we need Adonai Tzevaot, the Lord of hosts, to sometimes intercede on our behalf, right? We pray, God answers, God releases an answer, but sometimes in the spiritual realm, there's a conflict. There's heavy congestion on the H1, and the answers don't get to us right away. So we need to know that so we can pray more effectively, right? As I was studying this, doesn't this make you want to pray more? Doesn't this make you just want to, you know, you pray for something and you don't get the answer right away? What are you going to do? You know what I'm going to pray for now? I'm going to ask God for some more angels, right? God, I need more help, right? Because we know God answers prayer. But something in the spirit realm can be hindering the answers, right? Okay, so how do we wrap all this up? God wants us to experience him as Adonai Tzevaot, the Lord of hosts, right? And this Lord, he comes to support us. He comes to fight for us in the spiritual battle that we may not even be aware there's a spiritual battle, but there's a spiritual battle around us. And he comes to fight for us. When we're in a situation, we take a stand for the Lord, like David did with Goliath. Adonai Tzevaot is there to support us, to help us, to empower us, to give us strength, courage. He's actually fighting for us, right? You get this picture? God is not just like passively like, oh yes, the Lord is with me. He's like walking along. He's fighting for us. He's battling for us. When we're praying and we're not seeing the answers yet, he's fighting for us. He's in a great spiritual battle, right? And see, life is not a resting place. It's a testing place, right? We're here. We're being tested. And because of this battle, we've got to begin to pray. And if we don't know anything about angels, we would never know to pray about an angel helping to bring an answer to prayer. But now, you know what? After reading this, after studying all this, I'm encouraged to not only pray one time and say, Lord, can I have, you know, Lord, bless this person, Lord, heal this person. But then when I don't see the answer, you know what I'm encouraged now to do? I'm encouraged to go, Lord, you know, I know you want to heal this person, but we need more help. God, would you send your angels to minister to Diane? You know, we've been praying for Diane's her eyes and her issue. God, would you just send angels to minister to Diane right now? Because we've been praying for her and we've been contending for her, but God, we need more help. Something in the spiritual realm is just preventing Diane from being healed. So would you come, send your angels, support Diane, bless Diane, help her, right? I'm just so encouraged that, that God tells us, I am the Lord of hosts. But we need to know what that means. We need to know when we're in trouble, we can ask for reinforcements, right? That is Adonai Tzevaot. And I hope that encourages you. Would you pray with me? Father, it's amazing to know that you are the Lord Almighty. You are the Lord of hosts, God. And when you come and you stand with us, God, you empower us to do great things for you. You empower us to take a stand for you, to do what's right. God, you empower our prayers. And Father, I just thank you that you send your angels, and they are ministering spirits sent to help us and sent to support us. We're not going to go overboard into what, you know, into all this stuff and get crazy with angels. But we just know, Father, that you've sent your angels as a support for us. And so, Father, when we need a little bit of extra help, would you send your angels to assist us? Father, when we need an encouraging word, Father, would you release those angels to give us messages from you? And God, we just thank you that you've set up this whole system, God. You set up this whole thing so that we would take a stand for you and we would begin to see you fighting on our behalf and you moving mountains on our behalf. So I just thank you so much, Lord, for your love, your kindness, your support of us. And I pray, Lord, that we would understand the Lord of hosts and how he can intersect and manifest his presence in our daily life as we pray and as we seek you. And I ask for that all, God, in Jesus' name.